During colonial rule, manufacturing in America was restricted by England. America would turn over raw materials to the British for manufacturing articles, which colonists had to buy at advanced prices. It was dependent upon England for basic necessities and isolated from the developments in industrialism that were taking place across Europe. Changes to the status quo were envisioned by Alexander Hamilton, the first Secretary of the Treasury, who saw it as his task to introduce these industrial developments to the new government. He stated to President George Washington and the cabinet that America, to be free from British influence, must be industrially free.
Washington, Lafayette, and Alexander Hamilton saw the falls, and it made a very strong impression on Alexander Hamilton. He said, "This water is power. We should construct an industrial city at this location." And after the revolution was won and Hamilton became the Treasury Secretary, he wrote a very important report, the report which Hamilton's thinking is responsible for the prosperity of the United States. It was the report on the subject of manufactures. And there was an argument because the Tories and the British wanted the United States to be an agricultural society, but not advanced, not with breakthroughs in science. They wanted us to be a colony so we could produce cotton, tobacco, no finished goods. Sounds familiar. And Hamilton was very polemical. He said, no, manufacturers increase the power of labor, they increase the division of labor, they increase the objects of the human mind, and that manufacturers are constant. Agriculture depends on the weather and all kinds of factors outside of our control. But if you're investing in manufacturers, then you can massively improve your agriculture, but you also create a basis for much more labor and increase in immigration. I mean, it's a phenomenal paper. And Hamilton founded the Society for Useful Manufactures, which still has its building to this day at the Great Falls in Paterson. And Hamilton's intent was that Paterson and Washington, D.C. would be the two federal cities of the United States.
Diane Sayre is a former candidate for the U.S. Congress in 2012 and is currently running as the independent candidate in the upcoming elections for governor of the state of New Jersey. She tells me more about the once working class community, which was a hub for manufacturing, textile, firearms, silk, and locomotive industries, all providing jobs for thousands of workers. In 1913, it was also the site of the six-month-long Paterson Silk Strike, which, though defeated, demanded the 8-hour workday and better working conditions. After its defeat, the source of employment and prosperity began to fade away, when many factories shut down or moved to locations where they could enforce harmful anti-union conditions. Upscale neighborhoods nearby, like Wayne and Paramus, which were filled with large department stores, some of them anti-union, also took shoppers away from Paterson and forced the closing of many small businesses, further hurting the city. And then, of course, came outsourcing.
What happened to Paterson really has to do with what happened to the United States. And this year happens to be the 50th anniversary of the assassination of President Kennedy, who was the last president with any type of future-oriented mandate. That is, why were we manufacturing? What was the thinking of the founders of Paterson? And we can get into that a bit more, because they had a vision of the development of the nation over decades and centuries. And when you're thinking in terms of the future, then you have a need for scientific progress. You have a need for industry. Kennedy was the last president with such a vision. If you look at not only what he did with the space program, but with water projects, dams, levees. So you have manufacturing centers like the state of New Jersey, which had at one point more engineers and scientists per square mile than I think any place on the planet. That was the last hurrah. And after Kennedy was assassinated, what happened was you had his brother assassinated, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, and the cover-up of these assassinations, and you had a deep collapse into pessimism and the so-called rock, drug, sex counterculture. And along with that was the environmentalist movement. So instead of the idea that human beings, through their creativity, could do good for the planet and for future generations, the idea became, no, we are a blight on the planet, we have a carbon footprint, we should not produce, we should shrink, we should be smaller. And then coupled with that, you had a takeover by Wall Street with things like the free trade agreement, so that our industry and manufacturing was shipped to slave labor overseas.
New Jersey Department of Labor statistics contested the fact that employment rates in Passaic County, which Paterson holds the county seat, have not increased in the last two decades. 24% of families are living below the federal income poverty level of $9,310, with many finding it difficult to provide for their families. 80% of school children in the city are eligible for federally subsidized meals. Paterson has a robust, diverse immigrant population, with waves of new immigrants entering each year. According to the American Community Survey, of the 132,000 residents that have lived within the county for more than at least 5 years, 60% speak English as a second language. 31% speak English less than very well. Some analysts argue that language barriers may be a large part of why there are such high illiteracy rates. The U.S. Census estimates that 50% of Paterson residents were non-readers or read below the sixth grade level. After my discussion with Diane, I reached out to the mayor's office in Paterson to set up an interview with Mayor Jeffrey Jones. There has been a lot of talk on how the current mayor has tried to bring different communities together to help Paterson back on its feet. A former U.S. Marine, Jones made headlines when on May 19, 2013, Paterson raised the Palestinian flag above its city hall as it proclaimed for the first time a Palestinian American Day. The southern part of Paterson, where most of the city's Palestinians reside, is called Little Ramallah.
We're a government, and as a government, there is a process. And the process is supported by law, which says that any group or an individual who wants to do so forth and so on needs to do the application. They do the application, our lawyers or whomever is part of the team takes a look at it. You're entitled, unless there's some reason legally that we don't have to or can't do it, we would say no. In this case, there is no legal reason not to. I don't support or dissupport. So when the folks said that they wanted to do the application, obviously like anything that might be controversial, I've got to run it through our system. And I was told by one of our attorneys, and I quote, "You'd have more problems if you didn't do it than if you did." I says, I understand. I'm not asking not to. I'm saying, what's the challenge? There is no challenge. We have two flagpoles. And if you came through the front, you'll see. One always holds Old Glory, and the other, with our 52 nationalities and plus ethnic groups, and the fact that we've been a migrant city since the beginning of time, has always given support to anybody who would find Paterson to be their home. Well, the very purpose of flag raising is to say we recognize you as part of the community. That's all it says. So the flag, a flag, will be raised. That community assembles and for itself says that we are recognized here in America.
The mayor has his own plans for revitalizing Paterson's economy, first and foremost by recognizing its historical past and incorporating it with its new diverse population. I met with Jones and Paterson to talk about the challenges and opportunities he sees for his city.
When I took over office, that many urban centers or urban cities experience insufficient funds, reducing tax base, a community of people of, in our particular case, of 52 different nationalities, ethnic groups, and dialects who have been kept separate, siloed, based on either cultural reasons, political reasons, economic reasons, educational reasons, and only coming together when challenges would affect them so directly, not perhaps not understanding or realizing or maybe not being that being the focus, if we use that same energy consistently and collectively, that we could bring about reform. And so that's the similarities and dissimilarities. The progressive is we've had to make a real conscientious approach to what things we could resolve, because you can't deal with and fix the human condition per se. You can try, but the social science needs and all the psychologists, psychiatrists, all of that to understand our behaviors and our disconnects would take a lifetime. So we invested in the infrastructural issues, making sure that our departments and our staff and our mission statements and our goals and objectives, our equipment, our pay-as-we-go, our accountability. We make sure we put that in place.
Jones says that poverty has been a constant in Paterson, even when the city was going through an industrial transition. Those conditions have left the city and those that do pay tax with a heavy burden.
The backstory is many folks came to Paterson because they were fleeing wherever they were fleeing, be it economic, spiritual, religious, cultural, they left. They went somewhere that they thought they would have an opportunity. And during that time, as we were growing up to be an industrialized city, we needed labor. So labor came. And folks would write letters, send messages, whatever, and more folks would come. Hence, the siloing began. But people worked. And at that time, which is very consistent with today, they were poor. So poor is one of the constants. Obviously, there are some bodies of people who have grown and developed and moved out, but the vast majority remains, and the remnants are some of the wards, districts that still have those challenges. So to know the history as to how we got here and to understand that in that transition from the very first days of the immigrants and the migrants, we became a city of need, and we became a city that started to host the needs for the poor. Hence, county services, state, federal services for the poor. Not solely, but for the poor. Present day, we have a host of drug clinics. We have a host of nonprofits. We have 365 churches. And that came about probably because there were so many people whose living conditions, social conditions, and others needed spiritual guidance. At least that's what the framers believed. And they felt that that would be necessary.
The unemployment rate is at around 18% compared to the national average of about 8%. And like the national picture, these numbers tend to fluctuate, often because people stop looking for jobs. The industrial buildings that had once employed more than half of the population are now dormant buildings scattered around the city as reminders of the thousands of jobs that the residents of Paterson have lost throughout the years. But the city's mayor says that with so many vacant factory buildings, had there been a will by the government, Paterson would have seen an improvement in the status quo.
Assets. Our assets are we have 30 mill buildings still in the city. Our assets are that the federal government has pronounced that it has a desire to bring those types of buildings back online to do assembly and manufacturing. Our reality is those 30 mill buildings have been here for decades, but Main Street, Wall Street has not come down Market Street or Main Street and say, listen, we're going to convert these buildings to factories. They're not going to do it.
When the mayor didn't see traditional sister city relationships working, he sought a new market abroad with countries like China, South Korea, and Peru.
Our exploration took a look at our close proximity to New York, which is 15 minutes or so. The fact that we have a labor force that can be trained, the fact that we have an institution of higher learning and a few others, and William Paterson and Montclair in close proximity. So we started bringing together all of our resources, our Small Business Development Center, our UEZ, our university friends, our Chamber of Commerce, our PRC, we start talking about surveys of our city, our thoroughfares so that we can get trucks in should we move to a manufacturing base, what kind of tax incentives, if at all, we could offer to bring folks in. And then, out of nowhere, we got a couple of how you doings from China, Yulin City, and several of the delegations from various provinces in China came. We have hosted several groups from Peru, and most recently Gamara, and they're a textile city. I've hosted and will be, and am expecting a visit shortly from South Korea. And we have begun conversations with Turkey, and the mayor of Solderino, Italy, will be coming here in October. So, rather than just do a typical and traditional sister city relationship, we've looked at international investment and trade. And we've offered the notion that we have these mill buildings that can be converted into manufacturing and assembly facilities. And our proximity to New York would give them a tremendous benefit in terms of square footage and proximity.
Jones says he's already signed several agreements to engage in discussion next month. And several of those nations are already planning on coming to Paterson.
And we are now looking at an international level trade council. It's already formed. And his purpose is to help facilitate those discussions. Because if not for that, the normal protocol and approach that a nation would have in order to get into a city and do manufacturing and assembly or whatever the deal would be, they'd have to go to either Washington or US level, or they go to the state level. And Washington's not going to direct them. The state will direct them to cities, and it won't be us.
However, not everyone is on the same page as Jones. Critics say details of these trips have often been vague, and the question often remains on who is actually paying for these trips abroad. In 2012, the city was forced to lay off 125 officers due to budget cuts. I asked Jones about the layoffs and whether Paterson will be able to safely host the international market he plans to bring in.
Out of the 125 officers, we brought back maybe 75%. We just brought on or just petitioned to bring on another 46. But the transition between the layoffs is retirement. Within that, and partly because the state has instituted a 1.5% increase in pension and some other things, the officers who are at the point where they can retire are taking that. So we're losing that experience, and we also have to get permission, if you will, from the state to hire, because our budget has to be able to support it.
Mayor Jeffrey Jones finally tells me that he's open to have a bigger conversation about the challenges Paterson faces, but the other side has to be willing to sit at the table as well, from the state to the federal government. He also tells me about his determination in engaging the public in the discussion, something he's been passionate about since taking office in 2010.